This morning. Thank you, choir, for helping out with that. Mixing things up a little bit as far as timing. Trying to remember what we have. Okay, y'all stand and grab a hymn book and turn to page 422. 422. We're all gonna sing together now. The theme is Jesus. And our relationship in Jesus and what he means to us. And you look around to find hope in this world, and there's no other hope.
That's right.
No, not one.
That's
right? Amen. He's the one and only. So page 422, we're going to sing the first, third, and fifth verses together this morning. No, not one. Y'all be happy. Sing out.
Amen.
Praise.
Psalms 119. Blessed are the undefiled in the way, who walk in the law of the Lord. Blessed are they that keep his testimonies and that seek him with the whole heart.
Amen.
Believe it or not, coming up this Thursday, it will be 9 years since our church was arsoned and burnt down. I had several people this week actually asking me about the church. And actually yesterday somebody was asking about it and said, oh, that was horrible. And I said, no, it was a blessing. Mm-hmm. Yes. Yes. One of the things that we have brought out, I think, over the years since then is, and I appreciate Brother Rick on continuing the course. We kept doing the things we had been doing. Did the building make us quit being, the building gone, did that make us quit being North Beaver?
No.
No. Did it keep us from helping others? We've got a done unto me here in 2 weeks. What did we do when our building was gone? We still did done unto me. Other people let us use their facilities. God has blessed us. But we've stayed the course.
Amen.
Let's have a moment of prayer. Heavenly Lord, we just thank you so much for all that you've done for us. Lord, we thank you for seeing us through the hard times.
Yes.
Thank you for being with us always, even in the good times. Help us to always recognize you. Help us to always give you credit for all that happens, all that we accomplish. Lord, we could do none of it without you.
That's right.
Again, Lord, we thank you for just being our Savior, being our guide, being our refuge. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Do remember, we have Done Unto Me in 2 weeks. And you still got opportunities to buy a butt. And I've always said, Vicky's already bought me, so you can't buy this butt.
No return.
I'm her butt. No, I'm joking. But if you want to buy a butt, see Vicky, see some of us. You know, the reason we do that is the more money we can cover on the cost, the more money we can have to share to the ones in need in our community. Things will kick off. I know Brother Lloyd will start cooking probably 10 o'clock on Friday night, that Friday night. I think it's the 7th. I don't have a calendar, so.
Yeah.
I think it's the 7th when we actually have it. Yeah, so about 7 o'clock that morning, we'll start crank up the yard sale. About 10:30 or 11, we'll start selling barbecue. So be telling others about it. We'll try to get a few signs up here and there between now and then to let people know. So also, do remember, 2 weeks after that, we have the associational meetings here. That's on Saturday morning. So the ladies will be getting more in contact with us on what they need us to do. And, you know, as Brother Rick said, we need parking, people, and all kind of stuff on that day. So look forward to that. And we had a good time with the horses yesterday.
Yay.
Yeah, it was a good day. The kids were all excited riding the horses. I'm not a horse person. Oh, yeah, Linda got on a horse. I did see that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Is that your first time? No.
Yeah.
First time in a long time.
Birthday present for her, Roger? Yeah. But we did have a good time. The kids had a good time. So we appreciate everybody coming out for that. Appreciate the Cowboy Church and their ministry through their horses and things like that. So be much in prayer for them. They meet out here at the Blue Ridge Civic Center or whatever that's called now out there at the top of the mountain. So be much in prayer for them. Seen a dear friend yesterday that goes to that church, and we got to talk to him for a little bit. So got a right smart going on the next few weeks. So be much in prayer for all the events that we have, and we'll turn this back over to Miss April.
All right. I'm going to get y'all to stand one more time, and please turn to page 435. 435, we're going to sing about Jesus a little bit more.
Yeah.
What a friend. A friend like no other. We're going to sing all three verses. Ushers, we will take the offering at this time, so if you'll come forward, we'll take care of that. And let's just sing and praise and love him today. Okay. Jesus changed children. We'll do that too. All right, page 435, all three verses. What a friend we have in Jesus, all our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to care. Often forfeit, oh, what needless pain we bear, all because we do not carry Take it to the Lord in prayer. Do thy friends despise, forsake thee. Take it to the Lord in prayer. In his arms he'll take and shield thee. Thou wilt find a solace there.
God, our Father, we just thank you for this time we have, Lord. We can meet in your house, dear God, and hear your word. Lord, just pray that you be with Preacher Rick this morning, Lord, as he brings the message. Lord, we pray for all the sick and the shed in, Lord. You'll be with them and bless them, Lord. Pray now that you use this money for the upbuilding of thy kingdom. These things are asked in thy name.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. I have a guitar player coming at some point. But we're going to sing a song. There he is. We're going to sing a song for you today. I'll clear some of this out. You know, it's funny, and I just remembered this while I was standing over there a minute ago. I had a really weird dream last night, and it was about church. Like, we were here for Sunday, and I don't remember the specifics about it, but, like, I was standing over there, and there was just all kinds of, like, things going on, like, all kinds of distractions. And I remember just before I woke up thinking, like, this isn't the point. Stop being distracted. And I think, you know, maybe the Holy Spirit was using that to help kind of remind me where I need to be in my personal walk with the Lord right now. Because there's a lot in the world right now. There's a lot of stressors. There's a lot to get discouraged about and to focus on apart from what's really important and what's really going to give you that lasting, that endurance to make it through the bad times. So that's kind of actually what this song is about, and we didn't decide to do this until just a little while ago, actually. So I think the Lord's kind of working some things together, but this is kind of what it's about. It's that, like, that call just to be focused on God, focused on Jesus, and living your life for that above all else. So I'll just pray for us.
Bless you.
In this world, I walk alone, with no place to call my home. But there is one who holds my hand on rugged roads through barren lands. The way is dark, the road is steep, but he's become my eyes to see, the strength to climb, my griefs to bear, the Savior lives inside me there. I find another voice inside my mind. It comforts me and bids me live inside the love the Father gives. take my life and let me be a living prayer, my God, to thee.
Amen. Good job. Great message. Amen.
I tell you what, I'm going to have to preach hard today if I'm going to make up for all this good music. Isn't that right? Isn't that right?
Yeah.
All right. That silent treatment ain't going to work. My wife tries that with me sometimes. And I'm still there. It's been an eventful week. How many of you here yesterday for our Hallelujah Roundup? Man, we'd had a great time, didn't we? Good to see young people here. Good to see. We had about 50 or 60 or maybe even more. I didn't really count. Not all young people, but had a great crowd of young people. And I heard somebody say a couple of weeks ago, we ought to get some more young people here. Hey, we're doing it. You know, there's a difference between thinking it and saying it, and then you do it. And that's why we did that. And the Cowboy Church come over, and we had a great time. We preached the gospel, hand out tracts, hand out Dr. Graham's videos. We ate hot dogs, rode horses, even got to clean up after a horse. That was neat. So our back parking lot back there has been baptized, sort of. But it was good. It was good. And we're looking forward. Brother Carlton and I met Monday. I've been here. I was here every day this week since last Sunday, and I'm not complaining, but it was a busy week. We were here Sunday night or Monday night, met with the homeschool, Ash Homeschool Education System, and they're wanting to use our facility one day a week during the school year, and they're going to bring 100 kids. Amen?
Amen.
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 One thing you can't have, you can't have kids without letting kids come in. Amen. So we're talking to them, and it looks real positive. They're excited about the possibility. They're going to be using our downstairs mostly and getting together, and they're a great organization. So I think God's just opening doors for us. We're praying prayers. Let me give you another praise report. Our Uplands Reach Conference, and when I say ours, I mean I've been involved with it for 33 years, and our Uplands Reach Conference Center moved to the arena down there in Lone Hickory Arena, and we had our first summer camp, and the very first day, get this, we had 7 people saved. Amen?
Amen.
Man, that ought to make God's people go, ooh, hallelujah, amen. I know that's out of character for some of you. I'm just, heaven's going to be neat, because when you get to heaven, I'm going to sit back and watch. And man, if you can't say hallelujah and amen walking into heaven, I don't know about you. But what a great week it was. Tiring. Just a kind of note on me, I ended up worked down here on Friday and then went home and worked on my car. So about 11:30, then went to bed, got up at 12:30, and my leg felt like it was going to fall off. And we went to the emergency room at about 1:30, wasn't it? Something like that.
It's going on one.
Doctor said it looked like maybe a wound or a spider bite or anything. Something had got infected in my foot. And man, I was in terrible pain. So we were there. We were there at about 3:30 or somewhere around in that. 2:40. Okay. I have to go to her for all the exact. It's got to be. No, it was 2:41, honey. Let's argue about this. You're right. You're right. I went home and soaked that thing and they didn't give me any medicine. I asked him, I said, what do you do for pain? He said, go home and suffer. Didn't he? Didn't that doctor tell me to go home and suffer? So Jefferson Drug ain't open at 3:00 in the morning. So, but anyway, make a long story short, we were back down here at 7 or 7:30 or something like that. I think from about Friday on, I had 3 hours of sleep in about 48 hours. And so I was a walking zombie, but it was good. We had a good day in the Lord wow. But it's been a good week. It's been a crazy week. And this is what I've been praying for, that we get back to the business of working for Jesus.
Amen.
That we get back to the business of being a light unto a lost and dying world. We got our light lit up today? Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Okay. And we get back to the business of winning people to Christ, baptizing them. Do you remember how this week started? Had two baptized. Amen. And man, it just got exciting all the way down through. So we're just excited. Turn your Bibles to the book of Jude. And I'm not going to tell you what chapter. You're going to have to guess what chapter we're going to read. Okay? Maybe you can do that. Oh, me. It's been exciting. But for those of you that were worried about me and my health and my foot, I'm feeling great. I'm here preaching the gospel. The spider died. That'll teach you to bite me. The spider died. Jude. And we're going to actually look at chapter 1, because since there's only one chapter. And I want to talk to you this morning. Sometimes I tell you this, and I know you say, well, he must be kidding. I study, you know, 4 or 5 different things a week. And I've been studying about the judgment seat of Christ for believers. I've been studying all week about things like that, the last days, some other things. Been reading. My personal reading has been in Deuteronomy. Now, you don't think Deuteronomy is exciting. It's exciting. It's God's people moving into the land and beginning to be there in the land. And it's an exciting thing. And so I had a lot of things on my mind about preaching. And then God said, this is what I want you to preach this morning. You know, I think it was Lowe's the other day. And I don't have many clocks. I hardly ever wear a, up here on Sunday morning, about the only time I wear a watch. Because I know how it's important to have a watch on Sunday morning. But I went out, I was walking around at Lowe's, and I was just noticing all the different clocks they had. And they had one that was about that tall. And about, it was a round one, it was about that. Man, that thing, the arms on it look longer than my arms. And I thought to myself, how blind do you have to be to see that clock? Now, I mean, it was good for me, I could see it. But the thought come to my mind, do we really know what time it is? Do we really know where we are spiritually? Do we know where we are biblically? Do we know where we are as far as biblical eschatology? Boy, that's a big word, ain't it? Eschatology means timeline, prophecy, future things. The Bible tells us, no matter where you are in the history of mankind on the earth, and by the way, this book is the history of mankind on the earth. His story. It's got from beginning to end. God created the world. The Bible says in the beginning, God created heaven and world. In the last days it said, and so even so, Lord Jesus, come. Amen. Everything, you're in that place somewhere. Have you ever thought about that? Where, if God was writing about me today, where would I be in here? Would I be in Deuteronomy? No, I don't think you'd be in Deuteronomy. Would I be in Acts? No, you're not in the book of Acts. You're a little bit farther down the line, and we'll talk about that today. But basically where we are a Latter-day Saint. Now, some people perk up and say, well, I thought this was a Baptist church, a Latter-day Saints, the Church of Jesus Christ, the Joseph Smith, Book of Mormon. No, we're not that kind of Latter-day Saint. We are Latter-day Saints. I don't believe in Joseph Smith was a prophet. I don't believe in the Book of Mormon. If that offends somebody, too bad. I believe in the Word of God and Jesus Christ. But let me tell you this. We are Latter-day Saints. And what does that mean is, we are living in the last times, the last days, just before great prophetic eschatological events start happening. Now, they may not happen 100 years from now. Listen, God looks at time different than we do. We look at something and say, man, that's got to happen tomorrow. God says, I got that on the calendar for 120 years from now. You know? It's God's time, it's God's timetable, it's God's will, it's God's church, it's God's world. And so he's got his timetable. But I do believe the Bible supports the fact that we are living in the last days. I believe the last days begin to happen when Jesus came forth out of the grave, the church was born, the church age, that's what we've been living in for 2,000 years. I believe we're at the end of the church age. I believe we're drawing very close to it. And I believe we need to look at the Word of God and understand What is a latter day? What is a last day saint? What should we be focusing on? What should be our attitude? What should be our desires? What should be the way we live? Those are things that are associated with the last days. Now, if you were, listen, everybody that got saved from Genesis to Revelation is a saint. And that means it's not woo-woo, holy saint, build a statue of me. It just means you have been saved and God has set you aside. That's what saint means. He has set you aside and said, this one's mine. Do you know there's some things that belong to God? I preached a sermon one time on things that belong to God. Well, you say, well, everything belongs to God. No, but there are specific things the Bible says belongs to me. I read about one this week. It kind of surprised me, and I thought about it before, but it said, God was talking about, he said, I'm going to put your tears in my tear bottle. And he said, I'm going to record your prayers in my book. Isn't that neat? God's taking notes to your life. I try to encourage you to take notes. Some of you will never do that. I understand that. But if you do, it'll help you. But the thing is, God takes notes on your life. He sees the things that you go through and he writes it down. He hears the prayers you pray and he writes it down because he said so in his word. God's got things that belong to him. Well, we're a saint of God. We've been saved. If you're saved, born again child of God here in 2021, I believe you qualify as a last day saint, not just because of that date, but because of the things that have transpired up to this point and the things that I think are getting ready to transpire. This day and time, pastors and preachers, anybody, we get a lot of questions about, are we living in the last days? And I say, yes. Is Jesus coming soon? Yes. Well, even if it's 1,000 years, it'd be soon. But I don't think it's going to be that long. They ask us, when's the rapture going to occur? I don't know, you know. I make a joke about it. I tell them 12 o'clock. And they say, well, how do you know exactly? I said, it's going to be 12 o'clock somewhere. And that ain't a Jimmy Buffett song either. Okay? Come on, folks. Get with it today. Wake up. If anybody has a right to be sluggish and half asleep today, it's me. But I'm here. The spider's dead. Amen. People are getting saved. But let's talk about the last days. What does it mean, the last days? We're talking about that period of time that transpires up to the coming of the return of Jesus Christ. The second coming of Jesus Christ is the most prophesied, most talked about, more scriptures in the Word of God about than any other event that is going to take place in human history. You know that? In other words, the second coming is different than the rapture. We know that. The rapture is for the church. Church. That's when he comes and takes the church out. We're called ambassadors for Christ. A nation always pulls their ambassadors out before war begins. The rapture is going to take the church out and the church age will end. And then will begin the period of 7-year period of time called the tribulation period. And that is the time that God turns to this world and he says he's going to do two things. He's going to begin to deal with the world for their sin and rejection of him. And he's going to begin to deal with his nation Israel and their sin and rejection of him. He turns his, that's why it's called a time of Jacob's trouble. Okay? Doesn't mean there's not going to be Gentiles involved in it, but his focus is going to be on Israel. And his desire is that they repent, get right as a nation, and begin to be the witnesses that he had always wanted them to be. And we know that the Bible says that in that day God will seal. Revelation chapter 12, 13 talks about sealing of 12,000 Jews from all 12 tribes, and they're going to go out into all the world preaching the gospel. And that's called the gospel of the kingdom. And thousands upon millions will get saved during the tribulation period. And then at the end of that tribulation period, 7 years after the rapture, there will come the greatest event in human history. Jesus Christ will return. You say, well, what about, didn't he return at the rapture? No. You cannot find me a verse in the Bible that talks about the return of Jesus Christ during the rapture. He doesn't return. We shall be called up to be with him. We will meet the Lord in the air, the Bible says. He don't come. He don't come back to the earth. We go to him. That's the rapture. The difference is the second coming, 7 years later, he comes to this earth, makes a two-point landing on the Mount of Olives. They split apart. The Red Sea spills into the valley there, and things begin to happen. And for 7 years, it's the rise of the Antichrist, all these plagues and different things, and all the battles and stuff. And it will end with him coming. At that day, the second coming of Christ. And of course, you know, after that we talk about he'll reestablish his kingdom on earth for 1,000 years. So I told somebody the other day, they said, are we close to the end of the world? No. I said, if Jesus came today to take the church out, we would still be 1,007 years away from what we consider the end of the earth. But in reality, this earth will pass away, but a brand new heaven and a new earth, according to Revelation 21, comes and takes its place. So we're at least 1,007 years. We're Latter-day Saints, but we're not there at the end. But in the book of Jude, Jude was a half-brother to Jesus. And this is his only donation to the Word of God, but it's a powerful one. It's all about what's going to happen in the last days. It's all about how we're to live in the last days. It's all about what things to look for in the last days. This is our primer for how to live in the last days. Now, if you were living in the book of Deuteronomy or back in those days, I'd say read the book of Deuteronomy. Read the book of Isaiah if you're back there. If you were living in Babylon like Daniel, read the book of Daniel like we study in Brother Glenn's class. Because that's going to give you up-to-date news. It's going to give you prophecy. It's going to give you instruction. But if you're living in the last days like we are, we need to hear what Jude is going to say. And I'm not going to read all these verses, although we could and probably should take the time. But I want to share with you some things about living in the last days. What does it mean to be a last day saint? Well, let's start out. Let's see what he says. He said in verse 1, Jude, the servant of Jesus Christ, and brother James, that are sanctified by God the Father and preserved in Jesus Christ and called, mercy unto you and peace and love be multiplied. So he addresses everybody, and he addresses the saints here. And then he begins in verse 3 talking about the purpose of this letter that he wrote. And I believe I'm reading and teaching and preaching from the infallible Word of God. Amen. He said, beloved. And that's a term that only the gospel writers use for people that are saved. If you're unsaved today, and I hope you're not, I don't know if anybody that is, but you know better than I. But listen, if you're saved, you're part of God's beloved. Beloved means you are an object of God's love. He has loved you in a very special way. So beloved, he said, I'm gonna paraphrase something. He said, I had all intentions of writing to you about the common salvation. That's a wonderful topic, isn't it? Common salvation. We still don't know all we need to know about the common salvation. But he said, God spoke to me. He changed my mind. And then he exhorted me to tell you and to exhort you to take a stand for your faith. That's what contend means. Contend means I stand right here. Let's say somebody's coming down the trail here, and it's only wide enough for the trail. If I stand in the middle of the trail and say, you can't come through this trail, I'm contending for that trail. I'm taking a stand for that trail. Well, he said, I want you to contend for the faith. And that's something we're going to talk about. And then he goes on and talks about, he uses different metaphors from the Word of God, different true events that happened. He uses six historical Bible examples of what is called apostasy. What is apostasy? That is when people have believed something and now they don't. Does that happen? Is that happening in our world today? Are we finding people falling away from the faith? I don't know that there's going to be a great falling away. Somebody said, oh, the COVID-19 was a great... I don't think that's it at all. I think the calling away in 2 Thessalonians will be the taking away of the saints in the rapture. That's what the context of it is. But that's neither here nor there. He says, I want you to contend for the faith. So in other words, in this last days, our faith is in danger. How many of you ladies, if your children were in danger, would you continue? You'd fight a polar bear. Okay? Wouldn't be much of a fight, but you'd still fight him. Okay? I've watched these animal shows, and boy, that old mother bear, she rears up her back, and you can see the hackles on the back of her back, and she's protecting her young from either another bear or somebody else. She's contending. She's protecting. Because listen, our faith is in danger. We're living in a world today that is attacking our faith at every opportunity it has. Through the media, through magazines, through songs. I heard a song the other day. I switched it over through the channels on my radio. Heard something. It was talking about giving the devil his due and why not live for the devil. And I said, well, I know why not to live for the devil. But those are the things that we have in the world today. Our music, our culture, our lifestyle, the things that our politicians are saying, the things that our educators are saying, the things that our scientists are saying, and sad but true, things that our theologians are saying. We have people preaching from the pulpits of the Word of God, or not preaching necessarily the Word of God, but preaching from many of the churches of our land that are absolutely contrary to the Word of God. I was checking through the internet the other day, and it was preachers that were preaching on how Jesus is not God, how there is no heaven, there is no hell. It's just a state of mind. That's funny. The Bible says Jesus, John chapter 14, he said, don't be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions or many rooms built onto my Father's house, and I go to prepare a place for you. You don't go to prepare a place, don't prepare a state of mind. You prepare an actual real place. Folks, our faith is under attack. And that's one of the significant, most significant things that are going to happen in the last days. That the world is going to be turned against the Christian faith, turn against Christians, turn against the Word of God like never before. I know there's always been, I was reading there, and I couldn't believe that even before Jesus had stopped his ministry, there were those that were conspiring against him and saying, oh, he's telling lies and it's not true, even before he died upon the cross. I mean, the devil, you got to give him his due. He's right there, isn't he? He said, I'm going to go ahead and oppose this from the very beginning. So Jude is talking about that, and he's talking about those times, and he gives us a lot of examples of the way it's going to be. And he says here, look over in verse 10, but these speak evil of those things that they know not, but what they know naturally is brute beasts and those things, they corrupt themselves. Woe unto them. Folks, there's going to be things happening that your faith right now is under attack like never before. What are we going to do? How are we going to live? Well, I have several things I want to what Jude says here about how we need to live in these last days and the way we need to conduct ourselves. First of all, we must continue in God's truth. There's people today that don't believe the Word of God. That's always been the case, but now today there are actually organizations and groups and think tanks and all of these things that are just, their absolute one idea is destroy the Word of God. Now, this is not new. I mean, down through the ages, there have been people that have opposed the Word of God and sought to destroy it. They put John Huss to the fire and burned him up because he preached the Word of God. They did the same thing with most of our Bible translators. Tyndale. Was a martyr for the faith. That now we have the Tyndale House Publishers. Years ago, there was an atheist by the name of Voltaire, and he said, "By the end of the century that I live in, the Word of God will be dead." Guess what? At the end of the century, Voltaire was dead, and his house was the national or worldly headquarters for the World Bible Society. Doesn't God have a sense of humor? It was he that was dead, and the Word of God was still going strong. I'm not saying that we need to contend for the faith with the idea that the faith is going to disappear. But folks, we need to be the ones who stand in the hedge and make up the gap and say, listen, this is what I believe, this is what the Word of God says, and I'm not going to be moved from it. Listen, when I say this, don't misunderstand me. It doesn't bother me when a lost person says, "Oh, I don't believe the Word of God." Listen, they're dead in Christ. I mean, they're dead. They're spiritually dead. They don't have any spiritual sensitivity. And they're going to say things. But when people who claim to know God hedge their bet on the Word of God, oh, well, this could mean that, and this could be this, and that really doesn't mean that, and the Word of God isn't absolute, folks, there's where the trouble is. When God's people, and you know, that's what the most of the Bible is all about, God dealing with God's people. God's viewpoint of the world is, I've got the unsaved over here. My message is usually you need to get saved. Okay? He didn't tell them to live. He didn't so much tell them to live right, although he said the things you do are wrong. But it was the majority of the information and instruction he gave to God's people. He wants us to live a certain way. He wants to live a certain lifestyle. He wants us to be the light of the world. And when we don't do that, we don't obey him and serve him and live for him, we are a poor representative of the kingdom of God here in the earth. What happens then? People don't get saved like they should. Folks, that's what Jude is talking about. So I'm going to pick it up in verse 16. Let's back up to verse 14, because you'll recognize this name. And Enoch also, the seventh from Adam, prophesied of these, saying, behold, the Lord cometh with 10,000s of his saints. What does that sound like? That sounds like the second coming. Now this is kind of strange, because when did we last hear about Enoch? Genesis. Man, all of a sudden, Enoch was a man who walked with God, and one day they couldn't find him, and they never did find him because he walked with God and went home with him. So he's been sitting around up there in heaven waiting, what's going to happen? God said, I'm going to bring you back. And in those days, and he said, now he comes, he brings these 10,000 of these saints to do what? To execute judgment upon all and to convince all that are ungodly among them of all their ungodly deeds, which they had ungodly committed, and all their hard speeches, which ungodly sinners have spoken against him. What's the key word in that verse? Ungodly, isn't it? Boy, you're sharp. Not really, that is. If you read a verse and that word appears in it four times, that's a good indication that's the key word. And what does it mean? Ungodly means living like there is no God. We use the little prefix un as a subtraction. The doctor, you go to the doctor and say, you've been living unhealthy. What does that mean? You've been living a lifestyle that is not healthy. It's unhealthy. You see, it takes away from that. So an ungodly person is someone who lives basically like God doesn't exist. And we have a lot of people living that day. So he says in verse 16, these are murmurers, complainers, walking after their own lust, and their mouth speaketh great swelling words, having men's persons in admiration because of advantage. He's describing the attitude of the people in the last days. Now, folks, this is let me get your attention here. He is speaking specifically to the lost and dying world. But these things that he mentions here should never be mentioned among the people of God. We should never be murmurers. We should never be complainers. I fall guilty of that sometimes. Man, I get in traffic. I'm complaining about the way everybody drives. And it may be you. I don't know. Maybe I'm following you. I don't know. I've got to the point, I was following a guy the other day. So that old guy, that old geezer, that old blue hair, he's so slow. And I pulled up beside him, and I was older than he was. So, I have to watch it. But notice they're walking after their own lust. Their mouth is speaking great swelling words, prideful, boastful. When people get out here in these marches and riots and things and carry signs, like Brother Glenn reminded me the other day, he saw a sign about God, and then there was a sign. I saw a guy carrying a sign and said, Jesus is coming, we'll kill him again. Man, that's a bold thing to do. I wouldn't do that. But that's the nature of the lifestyle people are living today. But, beloved, okay now, he's turned his attention back to us, hasn't he? Why? Because we're the beloved. Here's how I want you to live. Here's what I want you to do in the last time. This is what the lost people are doing, okay? They're telling lies. They're attacking the deity of Jesus Christ. We saw that over there in verse 4. Look at this verse 4. He says, the grace of our Lord God into lasciviousness and denying his only Lord God and our Lord Jesus Christ. They're attacking Jesus and his deity. They're just attacking everything that's holy and godly. But he said, here's how I want you to live in these last times. I can't control the way the world does. Okay? But I've got to live in this culture. I've got to live in this timetable. I'm a last day saint. Okay, here's how I'm going to live. First of all, I'm going to remember and have a close relationship with the Word of God. Look what he says in verse 17. But beloved, remember ye the words which were spoken before you of the apostles and our Lord Jesus Christ, how that they told you there should be mockers in the last time, there's the key, in the last time, and who should walk after their own ungodly lust. We need to be in the Word of God like never before. You know, it's amazing to me as I read about the last days and the days before Jesus coming, like Hebrews 10:25 said, not forsaking the assembly of ourselves together as a manner so is, but so much the more as you see the day approaching. There's always, it seems like there's an emphasis in the Word of God and what God says, that we need to intensify our closeness to God. We need to intensify our Bible study. We need to guard those things that we have, and even more in the last days. We need to really gird up things. So here he says, in those last days, I want you to remember the words that the Lord has spoken. Well, how can you remember them if you don't memorize them? How can you remember if you don't read them? How can you remember them if you don't study them? A recent poll was taken. I think it was taken about several years ago. These polls, it takes a while to get them. And it was it was one of those, you know, one of them poll things about to Christian people. And it was asking Christian people who identified as Christians, identified as churchgoers, and they said, how often do you read the Bible? It was staggering. 30% said they did not daily read the Word of God. Man. I tell you, when you go visiting homes, a lot of times I like to go visiting homes. First thing you go in there, you notice if they got toys, they got kids, right? If they got dogs, you see dog toys or maybe a dog pail or something like that or anything like that. A lot of things that kind of give you clues. You look over there and you see that Bible and it's got a dust layer on it about that thick. Or I tell you what clues me off. Somebody's carrying a Bible, and thank God for them carrying it, but it looks like it just came out of the package. Man, I don't know about you, and I ain't fussing at that. Some people can't better carry it, but I like these Bibles here. You got to put duct tape on. You got to put glue on. You know, I've been preaching before, and pages fly out of my Bible, you know. Used. We need to intensify our study of the Word of God. I can't tell you how important this is. I can't give it all to you in 30 minutes one time a week. You go home and watch 40, 50. The average person in America watches 47 hours of television per week. And that's probably not, you know, there's going to be high and lows. How can I compete with that? How can I can't compete with that in 30 minutes. You've got to feed yourself. That's what I'm doing right now, is feeding you the Word of God. I'm opening the Word of God, breaking in you the bread of life. I'm feeding you a meal spiritually. Your spirit needs to be fed just like your flesh. If you feed the flesh, your flesh is going to be strong. If you feed the spirit, your spirit's going to be strong. Too many people, their spirits are starving today. Amen? And then they wonder, why I don't get no buzz when I go to church. I don't get that warm and fuzzy feeling. I haven't been blessed at church. You ought to come through that door back there so blessed that we have to open both of them to get you in. Huh? Yeah. It's your responsibility to eat physically. I don't come to your house and open wide. It's your responsibility. I'll feed you here. I'll study my heart out. My wife can tell you, I study, and thank God, I'm retired now, and I can spend a lot more time studying. I probably have more things to preach than I've got time to preach it. But still, I can't do it all. You got to feed yourself. So remember the words of God, and read the Word of God, and get familiar with the Word of God. What's your name? Carl. He came up here and said, Psalm 119. You know what significant about 119? It's got the most verses in the Bible. It's right in the middle of the Bible. And all but three of the 150 verses are about the Word of God. You're telling me God's not interested in us having the Word of God? You realize men and women, people died that we could have this Bible? Yeah. Get familiar with the Word of God. Second of all, we got to move on real quickly. Keep building yourself up spiritually. Look at verse 20. But beloved, building up yourselves on your most holy faith. You are a building project. Okay? I don't look at you, I don't look at any of you as being finished. Some of you are farther along than others. Some of you are like brand new. And then some of you are in the middle. But we all have progress to make. And the idea is that we've got to be constantly building ourselves up. How many of you ever have lifted weights? Okay, and I'm not talking about getting up out of the chair like I do, okay? There was a time in my life, believe it or not, several times, where I've lifted weights. And, you know, the thing about lifting weights, there's a little phrase, no pain, no gain. Believe me. There, you have to have pain. And the idea was, you've got to increase the train. One of the trainers that I talked to up at Martin Little's one time, he says, you've got to be moving up in your weight. I mean, it gets to where you can lift up 20 pounds easy, and then 40 pounds and 50 pounds and whatever. He said, then you got to get on up. He said, it's got to hurt. When you do your last rep, three sets of 25 reps of 50, when you get down to that one and in the very last one feels like you're going to die and you're going to have a heart attack and your eyes are bugging out, he said, that's when it's good. It's doing you some good. We've got to be in a building project. You got to build yourself. I'll take responsibility. I'm the pastor here. I take absolute responsibility for trying to help you build up, train you how to build up, encourage you in building up. But there again, I can't do it for you. You got to get in there and lift away. You got to do the work. You got to endure the pain. And you know, building up spiritually can be painful. I mean, how many of you ever picked up the Word of God and the first verse you read, God just beat you over the head with it? You know, maybe you're guilty of that. Maybe you've failed. Maybe you've lost your temper. I remember it's been a couple of months ago, and I lost my temper with a lady at a business, and I shouldn't have. I had to go back and apologize to her. I rarely ever lose my temper. I used to lose my temper, and it resulted in broken arms and hands, didn't it? Several times. So I've had to get my temper under control. But sometimes I say things I shouldn't, and I had to go back and apologize. And the very first verse in my devotions that morning was something about losing your temper. And always said, it was in Proverbs, and it said, a man that could not control his spirit was like a city with the walls torn down. I looked up and I said, thank you, God. That's all I needed. The first thing in the morning, you beat me over the head. Man, that went right to my heart. But I needed that. That's what spiritual growth is all about. That's what building yourself up, facing the project. You're a project. You haven't reached it. I haven't reached it. Paul said, I haven't even reached it. And brother, if Paul hadn't reached it, nobody has. But we got to keep on building. Too many have quit. Boy, I can't begin to tell you. I've been involved in ministry, I don't know how many years, 40, 50, something like that. Maybe 45 in all. Not pastoring all, but in children's church. Other things. I've seen a lot of people get saved. And sadly, I've seen a lot of people quit. Man, and they ain't a one of them, it don't break your heart. For some reason, they quit. They quit reading their Bible, they quit praying, they quit trusting God, quit coming to church, quit tithing, quit witnessing. They just quit. They gave up on the project. They're like an old house that sits on the side of the road that somebody started work on, and they just, somewhere along the line, they just quit, give up. Man, I don't want you to quit. Don't give up. It's too much loss. You need to stand before your Lord. I'm like old Mays Jackson, brother. He said, I want to go across the finish line in heaven, wide open in 18 gear, both stacks of cooking, shooting out fire. That's the way I want to go to heaven. I don't want him to pull me out where I've quit and, you know, the rapture catch me. Oh, man, phew. I want to stand before him faithful. We need to remember the word of God. We need to build up ourselves spiritually. Then we need to keep living a life of God's love. Look down here at this verse. He said, keeping yourselves, we're going to talk about prayer too, praying in the Holy Ghost. What can I say about prayer? Are we praying? Do we believe God enough to pray? So many people give up on their prayer life. We're exhorted so much in the Word of God to pray. And we need to understand why. Because prayer is our lifeline to the power of God. Mm-hmm. Nothing's going to happen in your life that you don't pray about. Okay? Amen. God answers prayer. But he doesn't answer a busy signal. He doesn't answer a deadline. I ain't got time to pray here. I don't know how to pray here. Or it doesn't. I had a fellow, they said, God had never answered a prayer for him. I said, man alive. He said, actually, he said, God had never done anything for him. I said, you get up this morning and breathe the breath of fresh air? He said, yeah. I said, God made that air. You drink the water? God made that water. And by the way, somebody, who was that down at the river pointing out to me? Roger, I believe it was. Boy, you don't do much, but sometimes you come up with a jewel. And he said something about the water we was doing down at the river. He said, you know, it's the same water that God created. It's just been recycled. You know, there's no pipelines anywhere. You know, the mothership hadn't come along and dumped a load of water. We just keep using what God has supplied. We need to be praying. We need to be trusting God. We need to be challenging God with our prayers. I'm of the opinion, and I believe that God kind of gets... I have to be careful the word I choose. I don't want to say he's sick of our small prayers, although that may be adequate or appropriate, but maybe he's disappointed in our small prayers. I mean, he must listen to some of our prayers or our lack of prayer. Remember, James tells us that the number one reason for not getting prayers answered is what? You have not because you ask not. Don't complain to me about how God is not blessing your life and giving you the dreams you want to have and being able to accomplish the things you want to do when you don't pray. But God must be disappointed sometimes in the small, weak, insignificant prayers that we pray to him that maybe a man could answer. God wants to be challenged with our prayer life. Jeremiah said, call upon me and answer me, and I will show you great and mighty things that thou knowest not. I've been challenged this year in all the things that I've been through to realize that God's got something up here I ain't prayed for. You know, that Ephesians 3:20. Now unto him that is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think. Brother, God's got blessings on the top of the refrigerator that I ain't never seen. Ain't that right, Heather? She said, we're not challenged. Hey, we're the right size. You all get to heaven, you're all going to be short, so just forget about it. Short and beautiful, that's the way we're going to be. But God's got some things up there that I ain't even thought about yet. That should challenge us. So we need to be praying, and then we need to be working, and I'll close with this. What kind of people are we going to be in the last days? What are the people out here in the world today? I've seen in the last few years, I have seen an escalation of hate, of division. Now, I know some division is proper, just, and holy. If somebody don't believe the word of God, and I do, we're going to be divided. But that don't mean I have to hate them. We've taken a complete turn in our nation, our society, our world, our culture, that if somebody's not just like us, we're almost justified to hate them. God in His Word says we need to hate the sin, hate the disbelief, hate the ungodliness, hate the wars, hate the murders, hate all those things. But He has never said it's all right for you to hate somebody. If anybody in the world had the right to hate people, it was Jesus. They put Him on the cross. He didn't hate them. What did He do? What was one of His last of His seven sayings from the cross? Father, forgive them. There's not a more beautiful, loving act of a person than being able to forgive others. Some of you have had some horrible things happen to you. Some of you are facing horrible things now. But in this world, bad things are going to happen. But you've been able to forgive. Man, it takes a boatload of God's grace sometimes to forgive. It's not that they deserve it. It's not that you can forget that it ever happened. When we say forget, we don't mean forget in that sense, that you become oblivious to it happening. It just simply means I'm going to forgive them, and I'm going to forget the mindset in my mind that I want to get back at them. I used to call them, didn't I? The spiritual IOUs that we carry around. Emotional IOUs, mental IOUs. You did me wrong. I remember it. I got it right here. You owe me this, or you owe me that. I was going to illustrate that one day. Had my coat on, you know, like this, and I reached down in there, and I put a bunch of little pieces of paper in there. And what I forgot, I wore the wrong coat that day, and it actually had $2 bills in there. And I pulled that out, and I said, "We need to forgive our sins," and threw it out there. Man, the deacon is so around. I'm just kidding, you deacons. I love you. I'll say this before and I'm done. We need to be loving people. Of all the people on this earth, yes, I hate abortion. Yes, I hate homosexuality. The act of all these things. I hate all the sins, the ones I'm guilty of, the ones you're guilty of, the ones the world's guilty of. But I got to be careful that I don't become a spiritual, saved, born-again cynic. Somebody that sees the wrong, the negative, no possibility of redemption, no possibility of getting better, no possibility, no value. That's the kind of world we're living in. If you're not of this group, they just check you off. You don't even exist. You don't even have personality. You're just not nothing. That's wrong. Jesus taught us that every human being has a value. Even Adolf Hitler, yes, as bad as he was. Even as Uganda over there, Uganda, Idi Amin, yes. Even Jim Jones down there in Guyana town or whatever, yes. Doesn't mean they did right. Doesn't mean they ever responded and got saved. But it simply means God loved them. You know, that's one of the things that I had a hard time dealing with one time. I couldn't believe that God loved sinners. And I was a sinner. I could say that, sing that, pray that. But then when I thought about this, I said, no. God loves sinners. We need to be keeping ourselves in the love of God, looking for the mercy of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. The last thing we need to be doing as last day saints is looking for Him. We need to have a heavenly viewpoint. We need to think about the things of heaven more than the things of this earth. Thinking about, it's right to plan. It's okay to plan. It's okay to have dreams down here. Nothing wrong with that if they're of God. But foremost on our mind and foremost in our eyesight should be, I'm looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of my faith. I'm looking for the Lord.
That's what I'm looking for. That's my salvation. That's my hope. That's my joy. That's my victory. That's my everlasting idea, is that He's coming to get me. Boy, if we live that way, someone said we need to live like He could come today, and then we ought also live like He'll come, won't come for 1,000 years. We ought to be busy about the things of God, but we ought to be looking forward to Him. We're last day saints. We should live in a genuine, real expectation of Him coming again. That'll make us live differently. It'll make us put value on different things. It'll make us have different priorities in our life. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed this morning. I ask you to pray for one another. Pray for yourself. Pray for one another as well. So our pen has come to play a hymn of invitation this morning. Things that are done today, decisions that are made in this place, are of eternal consequence. I was reminded just a couple of weeks ago that the next time I see somebody may be in eternity. A fellow that I know, a friend of mine, passed off the scene and I didn't even know it. That's the way the society is today. And I realized, you know, the next time I see him will be in eternity. Well, that makes you think different about how you're living and where you're living and what you should be doing. As our pianist plays the hymn of invitation this morning, stand with me. As she plays, maybe God's dealing with you about something. Maybe there's business you need to do with the Lord. Maybe the Holy Spirit is saying, child, this is something you need to do. This is a decision you need to make. Let's do some business. Are you in the Word of God like you should? We talked about that. The Word of God is just absolutely essential for your Christian strength and power and growth. He said in Psalm 119:105, thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Psalm 110, wherewithal shall, verse 9, wherewithal shall a young man cleanse his way? By heeding thereto according to thy word. He said the word was like apples of gold and pictures of silver. It's something precious and beautiful in an ugly, ugly world. Are you loving people? Are you building yourself up in the faith? That's what you do when you come to church. That's what you do when you come to Sunday school. That's what you do when you read the Bible. That's what you do when you pray. That's what you do when you meditate on. How many times you just say meditate on God and think about Him and talk to Him? Building yourselves up. Oh, you say, but preacher, I'm saved. That's okay. That's all I got to do. No, it's not. He wants you to build yourself up. Be strong in the Lord, because in these last days, your faith is going to be challenged. You loving people, praying, contending for the faith, believing the Word of God, not being swayed by the false teachers and errant teachers. That's what a last times child of God does. Whatever your need is this morning, you come. God speaks to your heart. Maybe you're unsaved. I don't go around assuming that everybody's saved. I don't assume anybody's saved. I know my own heart. I can look at your life and kind of make a guess by the way you live, the way you act, but I don't know for sure. Only you know that, and God knows it. If God's spoken, this will be the final verse. Thank you, Jesus, for loving me so much you died for me on the cross. Now let me live my life for your glory. Don't let me live my life for sin and pleasure and wealth and power, but for you. Thank you so much. I want to say we found some digging in the closets yesterday. It's amazing. We are the, if we're not nothing here at North Beaver Baptist Church, we are Olympic level rat packers or pack ratters or whatever. But we did find a little treasure. We found a stack of pictures from the past in the old church. I'm here and new, and it reminded me of your faithfulness. It was so good to see God's people working together and going about this and that. Everybody, Cindy was busy, Paul was busy, everybody was busy. There was a few of us lazy, but didn't do them. But it was good. We're at our best when we work together. And I want to thank this church. Sometimes along the line, preachers can get disappointed and discouraged. You don't feel like that they're doing any good. And I'm not saying this for me. I'm just saying they get, you know. But then I'm reminded, God reminds me every now and then, hey, I'm like Elijah. Remember when he was under that tree, that juniper tree? And he said, go ahead and just let me die. Boy, that's when you get just about as discouraged as you can get. And God, kind of Holy Spirit, knocked him on his noggin and said, I've got 7,000 down there that haven't bowed the knee to Baal. I appreciate this church. I appreciate your faithfulness, your commitment, your work. Every time we need you, you show up. You showed up yesterday. You're going to show up at Done Unto Me. That's how we've been able to do it for 19 years. Now I know in 19 years. You're going to show up every time the opportunity to serve God, and I appreciate that so much. Thank you so much for all the faithful service and all that you've done over the years. Thank you so, so much. All right, let's be dismissed with a word of prayer. We're thankful to have each and every one of you. Have a great day in the Lord and have a great week. And I think, let's see, what we got coming up? So next big thing will be, of course, we're going out telling people about Jesus all the time, but the next big thing will be Done Unto Me. All right. Brother Rick, would you dismiss us with a word of prayer?
Grow in your life. And Lord, we just pray for all.